It's time for security now. Steve Gibson is here. What a week in security this has been. He's going to explain what the SHA-1 collision that Google announced means and whether it's time to set your hair on fire. And speaking on hair on fire, what about Cloud Bleed, the huge security incident at Cloudflare? Steve explains all and a lot more coming up next on Security Now.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Security Now is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Security Now with Steve Gibson, episode 601, recorded Tuesday, February 28th, 2017. The first SHA-1 collision. Security Now is brought to you by Blue Apron, the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. See what's on the menu this week and get three meals free with your first purchase with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/securitynow. And by Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at quickenloans.com/securitynow. It's time for Security Now, the show where we cover the latest in security and privacy. And there's no better person to do that than Mr. Steve Gibson here from the GRC Corporation.
As you turn around and look at me on
just
the
make
screen,
sure you're yes, there.
I'm there. I'm here.
12 years we've done this show, 601 episodes, and something happened at 600 because for the first time ever, we didn't have an internet connection. We actually are starting about an hour and a half late because of that.
Yeah, I was watching the traffic this morning, and because I have all kinds of monitors, you know, because I've been watching my connection to GRC, and so I'm able to look at incoming and outgoing bandwidth and all this stuff, and I started seeing some glitching in the early morning, and this has been a problem in the past. And what the characteristic I've noticed is that it gets really bad and then it seems to get fixed. Like it got bad enough for somebody at Cox to get enough complaints that they thought, okay, I guess, you know, there actually is a problem. And so they go and, you know, shake some wires somewhere and fix it. So, I've always been nervous because the only thing that really is like real time, can't be put off. I mean, it's a beautiful day at the beach down here in Southern California. I could have been there, but it's the podcast. And so I've been nervous in the past that exactly this might happen, that there might be one of these cable problems at 1:30 Pacific on a Tuesday, and it finally did happen. So,
but you haven't had problems at other times, have you, or have you?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, this is consumer grade internet.
Yeah.
And I also watch mine much more carefully than most people do. I mean, I notice if packets are being dropped, whereas people are like, oh, why did Netflix just freeze? Oh, maybe backspace and try it again. I mean, so, you know, people put up with this, and but because I have a lot of instrumentation, I see what's going on. And so this morning just happened to collide with a podcast. Normally I just don't worry about it. I just do some other work that's offline.
A lot to talk about. I'm actually glad we're doing the show. There's quite a bit yes. in the news.
So this is episode 601. So we've got basically anchors at each end. In my little summary of this week on Security Now, I started off saying, if it leads, it cloud bleeds. So we have another project zero, aside from the cloud bleed problem. And it's so funny, too, because Tavis deliberately said, I'm going to do everything I can not to call this problem cloud bleed. But because of the obvious connection to heart bleed was there. But so we have that we'll talk about. We're going to end up with the title of the podcast, which is The First SHA-1 Collision. And I want to, again, provide some somewhat better context. You did a great job on Saturday with the new screensavers, Leo, giving it, you know, sort of bringing down the temperature to what is more reasonable, I think. But we've also got another Project Zero 90-day timer has expired on Microsoft, revealing another problem with IE and Edge that we thought was going to get fixed, and Microsoft probably hopes so too. We've got this week's IoT head shaker. A New York airport was found to have exposed critical data from its servers for almost a year, starting last April. Another danger created by inline third-party TLS intercepting middle boxes. More judicial thrashing over fingerprint warrants. Amazon says no to an Echo warrant. A fun drone-enabled proof of concept, which was widely misunderstood. And I think I also heard you talking about that and also getting it right. And another example of antivirus attack surface expansion. We've got some additional crypto education pointers, which actually came to me from our listeners saying, oh, and this and this and this. And we'll then wrap up by talking about what this Google's creation of a deliberate SHA-1 collision actually means. So
I think
another great podcast.
Good. And I'm very interested in hearing your story about your explanation on cloud bleed. I think you're less sanguine than I am. And apparently Tavis Ormandy just tweeted about 30 minutes ago that Google engineer who discovered it, and I think, well, I'd love to hear what you think, inappropriately, in my opinion, tweeted it before he contacted Cloudflare.
I saw his tweet last week.
Yeah,
and
that's
can't be good.
That's not how it's supposed to work, but maybe he thought it was serious enough that everybody should know before anybody knew. But he's apparently very dismissive of Cloudflare's explanation, and he says they're basically being deceptive. So I'm very curious what you think about all of this.
And there's a meta view to this, too, that we'll talk about. Because remember, I once, about a year ago, actually, said under no circumstances would I give GRC's private keys
to a
third party.
That's right.
And this is what everybody else has done.
Right.
And as a consequence, plain text from privileged communications was going to other people, is what that meant.
Right. So, which is serious on the face of it.
Yes, anyway. That's really bad.
That can't get much worse, Hey, before we go much further, though, I want to tell you what I had for dinner last night. Oh, did we have a nice dinner. It was a lovely recipe that we got from our Blue Apron box. Chicken and couscous. And I discovered a new ingredient called verjus that was just fabulous. It's like a instead of lemon juice, it's a very, I don't know what it is. I think it's wine. I don't know what it is. It was wonderful. Oh, I should tell you about Blue Apron. They're a sponsor. I ought to tell you about them. Amazing. So we get a Blue Apron box. You can get it as often as you want. It's not a automatic subscription. You never get a box when you don't want to. But I kind of love getting those Blue Apron boxes because inside, three meals you can get. There's two plans: one for couples, and then or singles who want to have leftovers, and one for families. And inside, everything you need to make an amazing meal. And what I like about Blue Apron, and they're the number one fresh ingredient recipe delivery service, but they have a slightly different take, so you should understand, why Blue Apron, why I love Blue Apron, is, their goal in life is, their mission is to create a community of home cooks, make incredible home cooking accessible to everybody. And that means these are not, for what you might consider your meat and potatoes meals. You can do those yourself. Your Blue Apron is very creative, very delicious meals made with always fresh ingredients, all from local farms, sustainable seafood, responsibly raised beef, chicken, and pork. Produce is from regenerative farming practices, so it's good for the earth. And the choices are amazing. I was talking the other day about the udon soup that I made. And the thing is, once you've made the Blue Apron once, first time you might go, oh, this is intimidating. Chipotle glazed meatloaf with crispy potatoes. Actually, I guess that is kind of meat and potatoes, isn't it? You get to choose, by the way. Go see what's on the menu this week at blueapron.com/securitynow. Moroccan chicken with prunes and brown rice. There you go. There's an example of something maybe a little more exotic. But, oh, man, I loved this this chicken I made last night because I found a new technique. They had say fry the capers first, make crispy capers, and I did. It was incredible. And then you top it with that, and then I sauteed the broccoli, which I don't usually do. I usually steam it, but I sauteed it, mixed it with couscous, this delicious verjuice sauce, some blood orange juice. They send you a blood orange. And everything you need is in the box. Took about half an hour. It's very quick to prepare it. The meals are healthful. And they're, by the way, and I always assumed, oh, this is going to cost more than if I, you know, went to the grocery store. No, grocery store is about 60% more expensive because, you know, Blue Apron doesn't have the overhead. So you're going to get three meals in your box, roughly $60 for that box. Family plans a little more because you have meals for four, but not a lot more. By the way, if you got kids, what a great way to get them excited about cooking. And the house fills with amazing aromas of this verjus and the capers and the shallots. And, oh, I just love this. Oaxaca cheese and plantain tortas. That's an example of a vegetarian meal. They have meals for a variety of dietary needs. Spinach risotto with fried leeks and mascarpone. Oh, we have that one. I think that's my next one. They even suggest wine pairings, although that's obviously not required. Blue Apron delivers to 99% of the continental United States. There's no weekly commitment. You only get deliveries when you want them. You can customize your meal plan, your menu every week. It's very quick. You just check what you want, and it's completely based on your dietary needs and preferences. They don't repeat recipes more than once a year, so you're going to really develop a repertoire of amazing meals. Like salmon piccata with orzo and broccoli, or pork chops and miso butter with bok choy and marinated apple. And you can see these are healthy meals, too. Vegetable chili and baked sweet potatoes with crispy tortilla strips. Spicy shrimp coconut curry with cabbage and rice. Check out this week's menu and get your first three meals free right now. With free shipping at blueapron.com/securitynow. blueapron.com/securitynow. You'll love how good it feels and tastes to create incredible home-cooked meals with Blue Apron. We just love it. blueapron.com/securitynow. All right, Steve Areno, fire away.
So the TikTok on this, what we're calling, so the official name.
Let's call it Clapbleed. We might as well, right?
So this is our friend, Tavis Ormandy, who did come in on the weekend last weekend because this was, you know, enough for him to have to cancel Sunday plans. And he was at Google trying to figure out what was going on.
Well, they needed to clear the caches because they had cached this information, right? They had
the official title was Cloudflare reverse proxies are dumping uninitialized memory. Now, technically, that's correct. What it really means is they're dumping whatever happens to be in the memory that is dumped. And if all of the users in the world are using the same proxy, and that's, you know, not the case, there's many different proxies and people are jumping around between them. But the point is that nothing scrubs the data buffers when someone stops using it. The buffer is just released back to the system, and the presumption is that no one will assume there's anything valuable in that memory.
Before you get too close to this, I should mention that we have been negotiating with Cloudflare for sponsorship, and I do believe they're going to start advertising on Twit in the next month or so. That's a disclaimer. We always have to do that. It's a potential advertiser.
Yes, and for what it's worth, in my show notes, which I haven't yet been able to publish because I use my workflow is Google Docs, and I couldn't get to Google Docs. I said somewhere here, I'm looking for it. It's way down. I said, if you do need to use a third-party TLS proxying service, don't use some random service no one has ever heard of. Use Cloudflare. The takeaway is they absolutely responded as best they possibly could. And this is, you know, this is like where we've seen a problem with LastPass. Yet Joe was on it immediately, fixed it in minutes, and then pushed the fix out. So, I mean, and these guys responded, the Cloudflare people responded as quickly. So none of this should be read as being criticism of Cloudflare. And in fact, my feeling is what you want is a track record of robust response to the inevitable problems which will arise, which is what they demonstrated. So, okay, so turn the clock back to the February 19th, where Tavis, as part of Project Zero, he was working on something unrelated. He called it a corpus distillation project. And so he says, he writes, on February 17th, I was working on a corpus distillation project when I encountered some data that didn't match what I'd been expecting. It's not unusual to find garbage, corrupt data, mislabeled data, or just crazy non-conforming data. But the format of the data this time was confusing enough that I spent some time trying to debug what had gone wrong, wondering if it was a bug in my code. In fact, the data was bizarre enough that some colleagues around the Project Zero office even got intrigued. It became clear after a while we were looking at chunks of uninitialized memory interspersed with valid data. The program that this uninitialized data was coming from just happened to have the data I wanted in memory at the time. That solved the mystery, but some of the nearby memory had strings and objects that really seemed like they could be from a reverse proxy operated by Cloudflare, a major CDN service. A while later, we figured out how to reproduce the problem. It looked like if an HTML page hosted behind Cloudflare had a specific combination of unbalanced HTML tags, the Cloudflare proxy would intersperse pages of uninitialized memory into the output. And again, let me make clear what that means. That means memory that doesn't belong to this conversation, but was almost certainly part of some previous conversation. And so one of the takeaways for our listeners is that this is a fundamental responsibility and a source of probably great angst for Cloudflare, because they are, to do the job, to offer the services they're offering, they're terminating their customers' sites' TLS connections. That is, you know, we've been talking in the last few weeks about these middle boxes. Well, essentially, Cloudflare is a big CDN middle box. And our listeners will probably remember a year ago when GRC was suffering those DDoS attacks and people were saying, oh, you know, you should go behind Cloudflare or some other service like that. The problem is that the only way to do that is to give that essentially that service which is going to front for your servers your private keys. And there's no way GRC.com is giving anyone its private keys. I get it that everybody else does, and that's fine. But what this means is that Cloudflare had plain text content of all of the HTTPS conversations that they had been proxying on behalf of their customers, the customers behind Cloudflare. And so this decrypted, very often sensitive data, which we're all now, you know, encrypting over TLS and HTTPS on purpose, in order for Cloudflare to offer the services that they are offering, they have to have visibility into it. They have to be a decrypting middle box, essentially. And that means they have plain text of all of the traffic going to all of the sites behind them.
And they have a higher responsibility as a result.
Correct.
I think your point is well taken in that regard.
Correct. Yeah. So what Tavis saw was other people's data in their data. That is data that, you know, like extraneous data and like passwords and session cookies and OkCupid is one of the Cloudflare people, and there was OkCupid data. And so, I mean, you know, potentially, I mean, the kind of stuff we deliberately protect with HTTPS connections was leaking across different users' sessions. So he writes, a while later, we figured out how to reproduce the problem. It looked like if an HTML page hosted behind Cloudflare had a specific combination of unbalanced HTML tags, the Cloudflare proxy would intersperse pages of uninitialized memory into the output. And he says, parens, kind of like Heartbleed, but Cloudflare specific, and worse for reasons I'll explain later. He writes, my working theory was that this was related to their scrape shield feature, which parses and obfuscates HTML. And I heard on the new screensavers, you talking with Nick. And for example, they are doing something automatically that GRC does. I have, for example, sales and support email links on my site, but the GRC server, whenever they change, it replaces them with images so that users can see the image, but that bots can't easily scrape the email off the site. And so, for example, that's one of the things that Cloudflare is doing on behalf of the customers behind it.
That's their email obfuscation feature, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And they, you can just like say, yeah, I would like that. But if you say, yeah, I would like that, that means they have to see the page their customers are sending out. And because, for example, bots are roaming those sites and trying to harvest for spam purposes email addresses. Well, instead, they transparently swap that email address with an image of it, which is not ASCII text anymore, and so the bot can't see it. But of course, this is how Google comes in, because Google is spidering all of these sites. And so the nature of this vulnerability is that anyone who happened to pull a page that had broken HTML in this particular breakage fashion would receive a bunch more than they asked for. And so as a spider, Google's job is to go and ask for every page there is. And so as a web cache, they became an unwitting repository of this leaked plain text, of other people's plain text communication data. They didn't want it. And it's sort of reminiscent of the problems Google got into when they were doing the Street View and sucking in all of the Wi-Fi. You know, they didn't want the unencrypted Wi-Fi, but it was there. So they ended up with it on a hard drive somewhere. So
and any web host would also have that situation. I mean, I have SSL with my web host, but the data that I'm storing there is in the clear on their servers. And if they did it, you know, so they have access to all my data anyway, right?
Yes. That's a great point. The problem here is that to offer the services, essentially Cloudflare is a concentrator. Right. That is, all these customers go through it to get to all of these sites behind it.
But you could, I'm just saying, you could say the same thing about, let's say, WordPress. It's a different service that WordPress is providing, but they've any site that's hosted by WordPress.com or Squarespace or anybody, has the same that same thing going on, right? They
Correct.
See everything in the clear, Correct. Even if it's SSL.
And so, exactly. So if they're exactly because they're on their side of the of the decryption.
Right. So when WordPress says, for instance, that we another sponsor I should mention, we host 27% of the web. It's a big concentrator too. It's just a different kind of service than Cloudflare is providing.
Correct.
Right.
Correct.
You host your own content, so you don't come up against this.
Correct.
You know what's in your content.
So Tavis writes, it became clear after a while we were looking at chunks of uninitialized memory interspersed with valid data. The program that this uninitialized memory was coming from just happened to have the data I wanted in memory at the time. So he says, that solved the mystery. He says, we fetched a few live samples and we observed encryption keys, cookies, passwords, chunks of post data, and even HTTPS requests for other major Cloudflare-hosted sites from other users. Once we understood what we were seeing and the implications, we immediately stopped and contacted Cloudflare security. And yes, somewhat controversially, by tweeting, would someone from Cloudflare please contact me? So he says, this situation was unusual. Personally identifiable information, PII, was actively being downloaded by crawlers and users during normal usage. They didn't understand what they were seeing. Seconds mattered here. Emails to support on a Friday evening were not going to cut it. I don't have any Cloudflare contacts, he said, so reached out for an urgent contact on Twitter and quickly reached the right people. So, bottom line is this immediately came to Cloudflare's attention. Nicholas got busy. John Graham Cumming got involved. And I mean, this obviously got everyone's attention. And they have some configuration, what they call kill bits, that allowed them to, within, in some cases, minutes and in some cases, hours, but again, only a few, to shut down these problematic services once they understood the nature of what was going on. Then the problem was that Yahoo and Bing and Google, I mean, any web crawler that had crawled over the last few weeks, because this was introduced relatively recently, earlier in February, it got sort of worse. And I'll explain the nature of this. And you talked about it on Saturday on the Noon Screensavers. Is any of these? I've completely lost my train of thought.
The search engines that cache the contents,
yes,
they
yes,
have
so they
stored
all,
those contents in their
right.
search indexes.
Exactly. So as the pages they thought they were retrieving actually had a bonus that, you know, they didn't want. So Cloudflare then worked with to spread the word quietly to get them all to clean up their caches to, you know, as much as they possibly could before this got any more public coverage. So Tavis went back and forth with the Cloudflare people. He was a little annoyed because he felt this was really an important problem. They were scrambling. Cloudflare was scrambling as quickly as they could to pull together a full disclosure and a complete write-up. And in fact, it was on last Wednesday or Thursday, that went public with what everyone agrees is a complete, fully responsible, beautiful disclosure where they explained exactly how it was that this happened. And I got a kick out of you commenting, Leo, about this loop termination condition, because essentially what happened is they were using a toolkit, and even though the toolkit could have been written better, Cloudflare took responsibility for misusing it, because in typical C power, there's a pointer which is auto incrementing and being checked against the end of the buffer value with an equality. And so this pointer is moving through the buffer. And unfortunately, the Cloudflare code advanced that pointer itself rather than always letting the library that they were using advance the pointer. And since the Cloudflare code advanced the pointer, then the library advanced it, and it did a double increment and skipped past the equality, skipped over that test for the end of buffer. And your comment was, completely correct, rather than testing for equals, test for greater than or equals.
Yeah, I mean, it really is basic. I mean,
yes.
Programming 101.
Well, you know, and it's funny because I'm sort of superstitious that way. All of my code does that. I use inequalities to test for end of loops, even though, you know, it should never happen.
No, it should always be automatic. Like, you know, there's no reason not to.
Right.
And I think this is as much could as easily be a typo because, I mean, of course, any programmer does that, right? You don't consider, well, will this ever happen? You just check for, you know, the range. Was this a library they use or was this code that came from Cloudflare? I'm not clear on that.
It was a library. And I can't remember the name of it.
They didn't write it.
No, they did not write it. And it is it's a beautiful library. I was unfamiliar with it before. It's a system that compiles regular expressions into C, C++, or assembly. So it's very cool. It's exactly what you want for high-speed pattern matching.
It's in something called Regel, R-A-G-E-L.
That's it, yes. And so, yeah, the Regel authors, technically, they didn't make a mistake, but their code could have been more robust by using a greater than or equal to loop termination rather than just equals. But again, to their credit, Cloudflare said we misused the library, you know, and they recognized how they, you know, if you're incrementing something, testing for equality should be enough because you're going to get there eventually. But that does assume that nothing would ever cause you to skip over the end, in which case you would just keep on going.
So the Regel code wasn't written improperly, but it probably should have been a better range check. Correct. Reason it was triggered is because the code that Cloudflare wrote for Regel, that Regel then parsed,
invoked. Correct.
Contained a bug that caused the pointer to jump over the end of the buffer, and then the lack of the proper check.
Exactly.
Didn't stop it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. And again, Cloudflare wasn't blaming anyone other than themselves. They said, this is on us. And again, I have no reduced confidence in Cloudflare as a result of this. I mean, the people who want the service they're providing have to make this trade-off that a third party will have access to their communications. I mean, that's what you have to do if you want this service. But for example, if today I were to choose such a service, and I wrote this in the notes even before you said they might be a future sponsor, so I don't want anyone to confuse this, you know, I would rather go with someone who has a proven track record of this kind of responsible management of problems. Because we know, if we know anything from this podcast, it's that
Stuff happens.
Yeah. Stuff happens. It's incredibly difficult.
And it's how you respond to this stuff.
Yes.
But as you also say, and I'll to be fair on the other side, when you're doing what Cloudflare's doing, you have a higher responsibility because there is such a risk involved.
And my point is that they're not alone. Remember that all of these middle boxes are doing it, and there are other similar services that are doing it. And if I were to choose a service, I'd go for one that had a service that had a lot to lose. I mean, where, you know, where as you, and you asked Nick, yeah, have you slept recently? And he said,
nobody had. The reason we didn't, we wanted to talk to John because he's been on the show and we know John Graham Cumming very well.
Yep.
But it was midnight UK time and he was, I think, catching his first sleep in close to a week. He's the CTO over there.
Yeah, that's all you could ever ask.
Yeah, but this is nonetheless serious.
Yes. So we have some new pages are on the internet now. The Cloud Bleed already has a Wikipedia page to formalize its name and existence. And then we have the site doesityusecloudflare.com, which is a site that allows you to determine if some site is behind Cloudflare. And one of the things
but
that
is that,
I
now this was the question I had. Is that fair? Because not every site would be impacted by this, right? Only sites that were using some of Cloudflare's service, some particular subset of their services.
No, that's every, the problem.
Okay.
Is yeah, is
I the, got that wrong then, because that was
every the flaw is triggered by a site offering technically broken HTML, but the trigger would dump the contents of whatever was in RAM, even if it was a good site that had flawless HTML. So essentially,
no, but I mean, just be not all Cloudflare subscribers with malformed HTML would necessarily get bit by this. You'd have to be using their email obfuscation service, one of the services, or would every single Cloudflare customer potentially be at risk?
Every single Cloudflare customer, because even though they made no mistake, the
dump could have been of anybody in their database.
Yes, their clients have had their data.
I get it. So you don't have to be a site that's using one of the services or with malformed HTML, but some other site could trigger a dump that might include your data.
Just because you happen to have been left in RAM, the contents of a previous dialogue with one of your visitors was still there sitting in RAM.
Right.
Yep. That's it exactly. So
those lists of Cloudflare customers, those are legit. Now, what Nick told us, and he said John felt the same way, is they're not changing passwords because, as far as they could tell, little was leaked. But on the other side, I'm looking at Tavis Ormady's tweets, and he's pretty angry at Cloudflare. He said, Cloudflare is having a busy day misleading and misdirecting. He tweeted that today, an hour ago. He also retweeted Pinboard's author, whose name I'm not going to mangle. Well, I will. Massage Siglowski. Sorry, Massage. Who says, Cloudflare has learned one lesson from Trump. Tell lies about the thing you want to distract from until the story becomes about your lies. So that's what I'm curious about. What is Cloudflare doing that's so upsetting Tavis and Massage? Or I'm sorry.
Yeah, without knowing what it was.
Yeah.
For example, so on February 23rd, John Graham Cumming said, last Friday, Tavis Ormady of Google's Project Zero contacted Cloudflare to report a security problem with our edge servers. He was seeing corrupted web pages being returned by some HTTP requests run through Cloudflare. It turned out that in some unusual circumstances, which I'll detail below, our edge servers were running past the end of a buffer and returning memory that contained private information such as HTTP cookies, authentication tokens, HTTP post bodies, and other sensitive data. And some of that data had been cached by search engines. For the avoidance of doubt, Cloudflare customer SSL private keys were not leaked. So he wants to separate that. He says, we quickly identified the problem and turned off three minor Cloudflare features: email obfuscation, server-side excludes, and automatic HTTPS rewrites that were all using the same HTML parser chain that was causing the leakage. At that point, it was no longer possible for memory to be returned in an HTTP response. Because of the seriousness of such a bug, a cross-functional team of software engineering, InfoSec, and operations formed in San Francisco and London to fully understand the underlying cause, to understand the effect of the memory leakage, and to work with Google and other search engines to remove any cached HTTP responses. And he's, and I'm skipping a bit, and he says, the bug was serious because the leaked memory could contain private information and because it had been cached by search engines. We have also not discovered any evidence of malicious exploits of the bug or other reports of its existence. So, okay, so I don't know what may have been said more recently that Tavis and others are specifically responding to. As we know, I've had my own internet outage this morning. But John was completely forthcoming about this. Now, I guess maybe the only thing I could say is that, you know, they're trying to put the best face on it as they can. He says the greatest period of impact was from February 13th and February 18th, with around one in every 3.3 million HTTP requests through Cloudflare potentially resulting in memory leakage. That's about, and then he does the math.
Lots of zeros.
Yes, 0.00003%. So, you know,
that's the real problem in a way with this, though, is we don't know what was leaked or what sites were affected, because we can't know, right? I mean, I guess Tavis and the, you know, people who have access to the cache data would have some knowledge.
The takeaway, and I'm doing the same thing as Nick and John. I haven't changed any passwords. The only thing, and again, so I would, the way to characterize this for our listeners, I think, is an incredibly, I mean, you can't even, I would have more zeros in front of, you know, like after the decimal, even than John. Probability of any of us actually being hurt in any way from this.
Well, that's the other thing, is completely random, as it was with Heartbleed. So there, you know, you don't know what's there. It could be half a password. It would be
lightning.
Be no,
it's like less than lightning strike probability. Right. And so if you want to do anything, I would say for the next month, increase your level of vigilance, you know,
and turn on two factor, which would mitigate this as well.
Correct.
Right.
Because even if a password or a session cookie, I mean, it's, for example, if it was a session cookie, someone could use that to immediately become logged on as you. But again, it's like we presume and Tavis wrote, we don't know that nobody else knew about this. Again, you can't, there's no way to prove a negative. So we don't know what we don't know. But it did take somebody fetching a page from one of the broken sites that interacted with this parser. And once again, here's another interpreter, which is bitten us. Interpreters are hard. That would have leaked contents that opportunistically happened to be in the cache from somebody else using Cloudflare beforehand. So... I don't know what it is that these guys are upset about. From my perspective, Cloudflare has been very forthcoming and immediately mitigated the problem, found it, fixed it. And, you know, the fact that you've got archiving technology crawling the web all the time, again, huge boon for us. Can you imagine if we did it? We just couldn't put anything that came into our head into a search engine and immediately find the pages that are relevant.
Right.
You know, that was the world 15 years ago. So even the caching spiders have a responsibility to, when notified, work to flush their caches of data that they wished they hadn't acquired, perhaps by mistake. So again, hats off to Google, hats off to Cloudflare. This is an example of a what would it be? Low impact, a very serious, very low impact flaw.
Well, and also for it to be exploited, somebody would have had to know about it before it went public, before the caches were cleared, and had been paying attention, right? Because at this point, there's no way you can exploit it, though, hoping the caches have been successfully cleared.
So say that somebody had a time machine.
You can go back in time and do it.
Yes. Yeah. So that they were able to go back in time. What they would do is sit there making, just pounding these broken services, these pages that have the broken HTML, and they would be sucking in, they would be deliberately sucking in what Google and other spiders were inadvertently sucking in.
Right.
And then looking at and to see if they got any treasure. Again, you can't target anybody. It's just whatever happens to be left behind from previous use of that same hardware by any other random person in the entire world going to any other random Cloudflare site in the entire world. And what's funny, Tavis did say, and in his note he said, "Oh, I had no idea so much of the internet was behind Cloudflare."
Yeah.
I mean, it was a wake-up call.
They're huge.
From
Google.
It's like, wow.
He's, you know, I don't, and also I apologize if Tavis used back channels to contact Cloudflare. I had read the initial posts from Cloudflare that implied that they became aware of it. I think Nick even said this when Tavis tweeted publicly, Cloudflare had been leaking customer sessions for months. That's how I thought they learned. If Tavis did some back channel attempt to contact them first, then I apologize. But I was a little critical of Tavis. If that's the way he announced it, that might have been because that would have been that was February 23rd. That would have been before he had cleared all the, or maybe not.
Well, and he, I mean, he may have reached out through email, not had an immediate response. And because he was panicking, he thought, okay, they're at dinner. I'm just going to use Twitter to like get an emergency message out.
And we're pretty sure that everybody like Bing and everybody else cleared their caches.
I did read that the Cloudflare guys looked at their logs, found all of the spidering that had been done, and then reached out proactively to the other caching organizations and said, "We have had a huge problem.
Oh,
we fixed
tweet.
It, but you may have something historical."
Here's the tweet. I do apologize. This is the first tweet from February 17th. "Could someone from Cloudflare Security urgently contact me?" There's Tavis's initial post.
Yep.
So that's completely fair. If you can't get hold of somebody, what else? You use Twitter. It worked, by the way. They did. They contacted him.
Yeah, and as I mentioned, I saw that go by, and I thought, oh, I wonder what that's about.
Yeah.
And, you know, now we know.
Well, yeah, this is it's an unfortunate circumstance all around.
Well, yes, it is. But it is also the consequence of the way our system is evolving, and I don't want to say devolving, but you know that you know Cloudflare exists to perform a service that many people find vital. So to do what they do, they have to, as you said, Leo, they have to take the responsibility. I wouldn't want that responsibility, but you know, they said, okay, we're going to do this to offer the service.
If you're going to be a DDoS service, don't you have to do that? I mean, don't you have to give, we don't use Cloudflare. We use CloudFront, which is Amazon's, and we use it for load balancing as much as DDoS protection, although it's effective DDoS protection. Wouldn't they have to have your keys and have to be a man in the middle?
No.
No. Okay. So there'd be other ways to do it.
They could proxy the TLS connection just at the TCP level, not at the protocol level.
They don't need to crack it. Yep.
But for example,
but the rewrites do if you want to do a
correct.
Yeah.
Correct. And I've gone to DDoS protected by Cloudflare sites where I get this weird sort of intercept page with some bouncing balls.
Yes. It says we're protecting from DDoS.
Correct.
And that you get that when the site is actually under attack, I believe.
Right. So what they're doing is they're using their ability to intercept the connection and injecting their own JavaScript into the page in order as part of the active technology to discriminate attackers from non-attackers. So again, I mean, props for all of the technology that they have brought to bear. And again, they're providing a super useful service. But you know, mistakes happen. And again, I never fault anybody for a mistake. It anybody can make them. I'm banking a lot of karma of my own for the day that I royally screw up somehow, because you know it could happen.
Cloudflare even said we've been in the process of replacing the Regal parser code because we thought it was difficult to use, and we've been writing our own replacement, just not in time, I guess.
Right. Well, in fact, I think that Nick said that it was actually the process of replacement.
Oh, that's right.
That
yes.
caused
right.
this to be to right. get a lot worse, and that brought it to Tavis's attention.
Right. Right.
So again, if Tavis hadn't seen this, imagine that this had continued. Because it was sort of a fluke that he even saw this. Looking at data collection on a broad scale and going, what is this? Did I make a mistake in my code? No, Tavis.
This is an example of everything working as it yes. should.
Yes.
I mean, it, yes. you know.
Yes, if we're going to have a system of brittle technology, and that's, like it or not, that's what we have. This world that we're in, that we've created, is brittle. So if you're going to have brittle technology, the best you can do is monitor it. You know, is keep an eye on it, and when problems arise, fix them as quickly as you can. And again, this is the way to do it, which is actually a perfect segue into the next story I had here, which is Google's report of another high severity bug, this time in Edge and IE, with no patch available. Microsoft was notified more than 90 days ago on November 25th. The clock ticked, and Project Zero gave them 90 days. Presumably, this is something that would have been fixed in Patch Tuesday 3 weeks ago, which we know didn't happen. So Google's Ivan Fratic discovered and posted details. I won't go into them because it's just mumbo jumbo mostly. But essentially, he stumbled upon a mistake in the way columns are parsed, either in HTML tables or in CSS, such that when he looked in, he dug into the code that Edge and IE share, a user controlling the widths and the spacing details of a table could inject their own code through just HTML properties and end up getting it executed. And he demonstrated that you could push this thing all the way through. So there is unfortunately, the 90-day expiration happened. Unlike Cloudflare, that had this whole thing wrapped up in 4 days and shut down in a few hours, Microsoft is 90 days out. And again, we still have the SMB problem unfixed. And now we have this that also came out of its non-disclosure timeout. So it has been the U.S. National Vulnerability Database gave it a CVE of 2017-0037, saying that it, quote, allows remote attackers to execute arbitrary code via vectors involving a crafted cascading style sheet token sequence and crafted JavaScript code that operates on a table header element. So I'm sure we'll get a fix. I hope we'll get a fix for this in March. And Leo, didn't someone say, I don't remember which podcast it was, but I heard someone tell you that it might have been Paul and Mary Jo last Wednesday, that Microsoft's internal patching system had collapsed or had a glitch or a fault or something like that?
I think I was joking about that.
Oh.
I certainly, no, I don't think we know what happened at all. You know, we can only speculate. I don't think Microsoft ever said why they killed the patches.
They've said nothing. Yeah. They just sort of said, well, we were going to delay it. Now we're going to cancel it altogether. Yeah. Meanwhile,
by the way, I want to correct it. My pronunciation of the creator of Pinboard, Maciej Czaglowski. Sorry, Maciej. So go ahead. I've been schooled in Polish. Sorry.
So in this week's IoT head shaker, we answer the question, what are cloud pets? So get this. The idea is that friends or relatives can use the Cloud Pets smartphone app to record an audio message and send it to an app on the parent's phone. The app then uploads the audio to the plush toy, a teddy bear. Apparently, you can get a unicorn. One of the security researchers said, I decided I would buy a unicorn in order to look into this further, using Bluetooth LE. When the child presses the animal's right paw, it will play back the message, you know, from grandma or whomever. They can then record their own reply message by pressing the teddy bear's left paw. The iPhone app then retrieves the audio via Bluetooth from the plush toy and sends it back to the friend or relative. What could possibly go wrong? Well, yes. Motherboard reports a company that sells internet-connected teddy bears that allows kids and their faraway parents to exchange heartfelt messages left more than 800,000 customer credentials. That's a popular plush toy, as well as 2 million message recordings totally exposed online for anyone to see and listen to. Since Christmas Day of last year, and at least until the first week of January, Spiral Toys, and I won't make any jokes about Spiral, where they're spiraling, left customer data of its Cloud Pets brand on a database that wasn't behind a firewall or password protected. The MongoDB was easy to find using Shodan, a search engine that makes it easy to find unprotected websites and servers, according to several security researchers who found and inspected the data. The exposed data included more than 800,000 emails and passwords, which are secured with the strong and thus supposedly harder to crack hashing function bcrypt. That's a good PBKDF, password-based key derivation function, which makes it more difficult to brute force. Unfortunately, however, a large number of these passwords were so weak that it's possible to crack them anyway, according to Troy Hunt, a security researcher who maintains Have I Been Pwned and has analyzed the Cloud Pets data. A different researcher just this morning, Tuesday morning, posted, his name is Paul Stone. He is with the UK-based security firm Context. He said, his post was hacking unicorns with web Bluetooth. And I won't go into the details, but suffice to say, for an unknown reason, these pets do not use any pairing. So anyone within Bluetooth LE range or longer, if you have a directional or higher gain antenna, is able to connect to a child's cloud pet and upload their own content. Yes, and that video is pretty funny. He's got the Daleks saying, you know, one of their expressions in a menacing fashion.
That's coming from Kayla the bear.
Not what you want your infant to be exposed to necessarily.
Destroy, destroy. Wow.
Yeah. So once again, another you know, as I said, a head shaker from the brought to us by the Internet of Things. We also have, a sort of off the map, but still significant airport 60 miles north of Manhattan, the Stewart International Airport, which apparently serves hundreds of thousands of passengers a year, is regularly used by the military. It's known for accommodating charter flights of high-profile guests, including foreign dignitaries. Unfortunately, the IT person who was a contractor who was set up to create a backup for their servers left the server and its backups publicly exposed on the internet since April, April of last year. This backup, there were 11 full disk image backups full of with hundreds of gigabytes of files and folders, including dozens of airport staff email account data, sensitive HR files, inner office memos, payroll data, and what appears to be a large financial tracking database. Many of the files that security researchers reviewed included confidential internal airport documents, including schematics and details of the core infrastructure. Others belonging to Homeland Security agencies were marked sensitive but not classified, including comprehensive security plans, screening protocols, and arrival procedures for private jet passengers. So, and then there was a file containing a list of usernames and passwords for various devices and systems, allowing unfettered access to the airport's internal network, according to two researchers who took a look at it. So, you know, just another example of too much data loose and unsecured on the internet. But it's very convenient to have your backups available. We have a news of a problem that Google encountered, which caught them by surprise as they began to deploy Chrome version 56. We've been talking about 56. That's the one a couple months ago we were talking about it, anticipating it, where they were going to start being a little more proactive and cautioning users that when connections were not secured. Not saying they were insecure, but instead of saying nothing, if you don't get the happy green padlock, they would up the ante a bit and say, this is a non-secured connection. That was Chrome 56. Well, it turns out the other thing they rolled out as part of their process was support for the latest version of TLS. Transport Layer Security, which is version 1.3. And then the problems began. Suddenly, reports started coming in of like people all over the place having no internet connectivity. They were unable to like get to all kinds of sites. And so Google got on it and figured out what was going on. It turns out that many people are using the Bluecoat version 6.5 proxy. Bluecoat is one that came to my attention a couple years ago. In fact, on the HTTPS fingerprinting page, I use Bluecoat as an example of one of these middle box proxies, which is intercepting all TLS connections. And we can already guess what the problem is. Bluecoat doesn't support TLS version 1.3. But the TLS protocol elegantly handles version downgrade. And in fact, that's been a source of attacks in the past where you're able to, a man in the middle can downgrade a connection in order to force the use of weaker security. So there have been all kinds of mitigations and protections against that over time. But here we have an instance where something which is trying to be transparent got itself exposed because its code had a problem with this latest version of TLS 1.3, which Chrome was the first major browser to bring out into the public. And then we had a worse problem because, first of all, they had to figure out, well, what was going on. Then they said, okay, well, you know, after much back and forth, and I've read the whole thread, they just decided, okay, we're just going to roll back TLS 1.3 support for Chrome 56. We'll take that out. The problem is, once people had already upgraded their Chrome to the version 56 that had TLS 1.3, and if they were behind a blue coat proxy, as a surprising number of people are, and again, this is another surprise that Google found, was how many customers suddenly had a problem because they ran across this. Then now the problem is your browser is broken, so you can't get it fixed. How do you, it can't update itself because there's no way around the proxy. So the researcher was a guy named J.H. Lee, and the thread goes on. I won't go into details because we're a little bit short on today's podcast, but I wrote in my notes, catch 22, once you've received a Chrome 56 which starts using TLS version 1.3 and you're behind a blue coat, distressingly non-transparent TLS proxy, you can no longer connect to Google to receive the update. So Jay did end up posting some workarounds. He said, first, to anyone who is affected by this, on your internal DNS server, that is, if you're corporate IT and you're running your own DNS, which your intranet users refer to, create a temporary address record, a DNSA record, that points clients 4, numeral 4, C-L-I-E-N-T-S, numeral 4, dot google.com at, and then he gives an IP address, 64.233.186.102. He says, once that's in place, restart Chrome, reboot Chrome devices a few times. He says it may take up to 30 minutes and a few, that's because Chrome doesn't aggressively go out to get new updates. It only checks periodically to see if there's anything new. So it'll take it a while to go and discover something new. He says it may take 30 minutes and a few restarts, but devices should get the update to stop using TLS 1.2. Okay, now he says stop using 1.2. I think that's just a typo. He must mean to stop using 1.3 and to use 1.2. And then he says, important, be sure to remove the DNSA record once this has been fixed. Leaving the record in place will, all caps, break things down the line. Second possible workaround, have the user visit, and then he has a URL here, chrome://flag/\ssl-version-max, and set it to TLS version 1.2. So you're taking at your client side, you're backing it down, saying we're revoking permission for you to use TLS 1.3, use 1.2. He says this works for Chrome users, but not if the problem is occurring on Chrome OS login screen. And it says, again, important, be sure users turn this setting back to default after leaving it on for 1 to 2 hours, meaning you would need to do that in order to get your Chrome updated. Then you'd want to re-permit, you'd want to remove that limitation so that once Blue Coat fixes their problem, this thing will get fixed. And then finally, the third option, the workaround, allow Chrome to connect directly to the internet for connections to clients4.google.com. That is, if the Blue Coat system has a whitelisting provision, whitelist clients4.google.com, then clients within your internet will be able to get themselves updated to the fixed Chrome 56, and then after that's been resolved, remove that whitelist from Blue Coat. So, a brittle system that we're all riding on top of, and every so often things break. Speaking of break, I think we should take one.
All right. And just for people who are tuning in for TNT, we're going to delay it a little bit because we got a late start. Steve's internet was down. And so we will continue on. What do you think, about another half hour, Steve?
Yes. Let's shoot for 4:30 to finish.
We'll aim for 4:30 Pacific start for TNT. So just a little bit late. Our show today brought to you by Rocket Mortgage. If you are looking at buying a new home or refinancing your existing home, I want to point you in the direction most geeks should look. Over there. That's not the squirrel
what?
I'm talking.
What?
Over there. I'm talking about Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. Quicken Loans, of course, the best mortgage lender in the country. And all you have to do, you don't have to take my word for it, is look at all those J.D. Power Awards, customer satisfaction awards, year after year after year after year. It's on their page at quickenloans.com/securitynow. You'll see them right there. So they're great. They're transparent. They're trustworthy. They've always been great. But now they're reaching out to us, the tech enthusiasts, by creating an online-only mortgage approval process. That's awesome. They call it Rocket Mortgage because it's 21st century. It's fast, easy to use. Rocket might not be easy to use, but it's easy to ride in. The Rocket Mortgage is very easy to use. And you can, in fact, because it's all online, you can apply for a loan and get approved in minutes for something that's exactly right for you. It's a wonderful, transparent process. You don't have to, dig through paperwork. You can submit your check stubs, your bank statements with a touch of a finger on your phone, on your tablet, on your computer. And you can even, there's even sliders. You can adjust the rate, the length of the loan, all that stuff. So it's complete control, complete transparency from a great mortgage lender, completely online. That's Rocket Mortgage. Whether you're looking to buy a home or refinance your existing mortgage, lift the burden of getting a home loan with Rocket Mortgage. Skip the bank, skip the waiting, and go completely online. It's at quickenloans.com/securitynow. quickenloans.com/securitynow. Equal housing lender, licensed in all 50 states, and MLSconsumeraccess.org, number 3030. You may not be ready to buy right now, but who knows? Sunday, you could be out there looking at an open house going, this is right. This is the one. Let's buy it, honey. Then you'll want to know, quickenloans.com/security. Now we thank them for their support. Make it possible. Put Steve on the radio or whatever this thing is on the computer.
While it holds together.
Yeah, really.
Yeah, this rickety
old radio. So, back to the story at hand. Do you want to? Well, I'll leave it up to you. Go right ahead.
I think that we got half an hour. This was an interesting wrinkle that I just wanted to put on our listeners' radar, and that is that this question of using fingerprints to unlock a phone, still unresolved. And so ultimately, what this is going to end up being, I think, is the right case needs to be found, and then we have to get this up to the Supreme Court. But in this particular case, a federal judge in Chicago issued an opinion on February 16th that was only made public a couple days ago that would deny the government's attempt to force Apple device owners from providing a fingerprint to unlock their device. Of course, the listeners of the podcast know that there's been this interesting compromise where the argument has been that using a fingerprint is not testimonial, whereas requiring the divulgence of a password is. So there was, that kind of awkward compromise. The 14-page opinion that this judge rendered as part of a child pornography case adds to the growing debate around individual rights to privacy and the needs of law enforcement to get past encryption techniques and technologies to further their investigations. It boils down to Fourth Amendment protections against unreasonable search and seizure, as well as the Fifth Amendment right to avoid self-incrimination. In the recent In recent similar forced fingerprinting cases, prosecutors have argued that providing a fingerprint does not threaten an individual's Fifth Amendment right to not implicate oneself. A fingerprint provided as a means to identify an individual has, of course, been allowed in court. This is, you know, Sherlock Holmes would be out of business if you couldn't use fingerprints. However, a fingerprint pressed into service as a means to unlock a user's smartphone is unfolding in courtrooms as an entirely different matter. While Judge M. David Weissman stated in the court document, which is still sealed, that law enforcement did have probable cause to search a particular home, he drew the line when it came to, quote, compelling individuals to provide their fingerprints to unlock an Apple electronic device. The case in Chicago also riles privacy advocates who argue that requiring those swept up in an investigation to provide fingerprints to unlock a device raises Fourth Amendment issues against unreasonable searches and seizures, which is to say, you know, there isn't probable cause to for investigators to believe there's something. They're just looking for opportunity to look everywhere. Speaking with Ars Technica about the case, Abraham Ryan, a Philadelphia-based tech lawyer, pointed out that, quote, there is a big difference between using a fingerprint to identify a person and using one to gain access to a potentially vast trove of data about them and possibly about innocent third parties as well.
Yeah, that's where this is going to come down to.
Yes.
You can't be compelled to testify against yourself. Your phone has so much in there that I think it's de facto a form of testimony.
Right, right. So anyway, I finish this up saying my take is that judges are coming down all over the place due to a current lack of clear statutory law. Even appeals courts are splitting on this. So we're going to need ultimate clarification from the Supreme Court. And these issues are so important to the way our future unfolds that we need to hope that any decision is carefully considered and widely debated. I'd expect to see a huge number of amicus briefs presented by both government and industry, you know, representing all of the interests. And at this point, we just need the right case to be argued and presented to the Supreme Court in order to get some law. Because right now, again, you know, the way our judicial system works is it's up to the judges to decide what is and is not correct. And in coming back to a fun topic that we talked about in November, Amazon is continuing to refuse to hand over data, which may, and again, no reason to know it, but may have overheard details of a murder. So remember, and we discussed this, that suspicious and suspected murder case in Bentonville, Arkansas, late last November, where somebody was found deceased in a hot tub. The local police investigators have asked for all available evidence from the connected home's owner's IoT devices. And as we discussed at the time, they had already obtained a data dump from the IoT water meter, which indicated a huge and suspicious amount of water had been used in the wee hours of the morning, with no explanation given by the suspect owner of the home. But they want to know whether the owner's Amazon device, to keep from triggering it, may have overheard anything illuminating. Ours reports that Amazon is balking at a search warrant seeking cloud stored data from its system. Arkansas authorities want to examine the recorded voice and transcription data as part of a murder investigation. Among other things, the Seattle company claims that the recorded data from an Amazon Echo near a murder scene is protected by the First Amendment.
Amendment.
As are the responses from the voice assistant itself. Amazon said that the Bentonville Police Department is essentially going on a fishing expedition with a warrant that could chill speech and even the market those devices.
That's a good point. That's a good point. Yeah.
And competing products. In a motion to quash the subpoena, the company said that because of the constitutional concerns at issue, the authorities need to demonstrate a, quote, compelling need, unquote, for the information and must exhaust all other avenues to acquire that data. And I didn't have it in the notes here because I wanted to keep this from getting too long. But, for example, Amazon pointed out that if this user had the A word app on their phone, then that app would have a record.
Yeah, you can unlock the phone with the fingerprint. Oh, he's dead.
Right.
Oh, no, the suspect isn't dead.
I mean, if this guy's got his water meter hooked into his home with IoT, he's got the Alexa loaded on his phone.
Sure.
So the point is, rather than just doing this broad sweep, they need to keep this from becoming overly broad. And anyway, so Amazon's doing the right thing, I think, for us and certainly for themselves, by saying, by pushing back against this, saying you, and there's no reason to believe that there's any data there. They're just saying, what
We'd
if?
I'd like to see,
yeah. Now, I doubt anyone screamed out that the name of the device.
Is
Call 911. So the case has generated a huge amount of publicity, putting heightened pressure on everyone on both sides of the struggle. Amazon needs to assure all of its customers that these devices are not surreptitious spy bots, and the detectives need to recover and analyze all possibly relevant evidence. The question is, where do we draw the line? And boy, essentially, this is a classic case of a whole bunch of new problems being presented by new technology. Just wait till the self-driving cars start causing damage. We're going to be back in court again. Okay, so this was a proof of concept. That's all it was. But because it was well executed, they had a video and a clever name, the press got a little carried away. Even UPI had the headline, "A computer's LED light can smuggle out data from the hard drive." And Wired.com covered this, saying, "Watch malware steal data from air-gapped PC with blinking lights and a drone."
Oh, Lord.
So in this dramatic video, we have the first person perspective of the drone, and with this industrial building in the background at night, and we take off and we somewhat hesitantly fly up to the building and look in the window with our drone hovering there, looking sinister in the middle of the night. And it finds this flashing light on the hard drive. Now, the key here is that this is an un-internet attached machine, and so a so-called air-gapped PC, deliberately running the other half of this experiment's software, meaning deliberately flashing the light in order to send the data out in a meaningful and high data rate fashion. So, and we talked about this a long time ago, Leo. Remember the network lights behind us that were, flickering away on the servers, and it was like, oh my God, there's our data being exfiltrated.
It's leaking data.
No, that's a packet that went by, and who cares? Because it's not showing you the contents. So this is worse in as much as what they found is that they could get about 6 kiloblinks per second, and they set up a 4 kilobit link, optical link, from this machine rapidly flashing its hard drive light, which the malware, their proof of concept code running in the machine was deliberately encoding with the data, and the drone was out there hovering, picking it up. So, you know, we've had a lot of fun on the podcast over the years looking at all the different ways you can arrange to exfiltrate data with, you know, the sound of the hard drive, the subsonic or ultrasonic sounds coming from the speaker, you know, just, you know, anything you can imagine that could be controlled, that could be sensed at a distance, whether sound or light. And so here's just another one. But this is not to say that anyone can fly a drone up to someone's window and, you know, I mean, you don't want any drones looking in your windows anyway. But, you know, having it look at your hard drive light on your computer is going to tell it nothing, especially if it's running Windows, because the drive never stops flashing and no one has ever figured out why. So anyway, not a big problem there. A quick note that just on this whole topic of a third-party AV having the potential to expand the attack surface, unfortunately, the securitylist.org has reported just a couple days ago a remote code execution as root via ESET's Endpoint Antivirus 6 on macOS. And of course, ESET's marketing material proudly boasts ESET Endpoint Antivirus for OS 10 delivers award-winning cross-platform protection for multi-platform environments. It protects against malware and spyware and shields end users from fake website phishing for sensitive information such as usernames, passwords, or credit card details. Of course, as we know, the only way it can do that is looking inside all of your connections. Unauthorized devices, they write, can be blocked from the system easily. The solution's highly intuitive interface allows for quick navigation. Unfortunately, however, vulnerable versions of ESET Endpoint Antivirus 6 are statically linked with an outdated XML parsing library and do not perform proper server authentication, allowing for remote authenticated, unauthenticated attackers to perform arbitrary code execution as root on vulnerable clients. That means if your Mac is running ESET Endpoint Antivirus 6 and somebody wanted to target you, I mean, this isn't just something that anybody can find you through Shodan or something. You would need to be targeted. They would need to intercept the periodic connection which the ESET daemon makes to check for its licensing, and it goes to edf.eset.com, which it uses periodically to verify that it is currently licensed. If that query is intercepted, then because there's no validation of the certificate, it's trivial for a man in the middle to leverage this XML parsing library flaw and run their own code with root privileges on your Mac. So none of this would be possible if you didn't have this thing in your system trying to help you. But again, because it has to be perfect and it's difficult to make things perfect, it ends up creating more vulnerabilities, one might argue, or at least a very well-known vulnerability. And I should have followed up, but I didn't, to see whether this had been fixed by the time it was disclosed. It looks like the CVE is 2016-9892, a big CVE number. So toward the end of 2016, my guess is that it wasn't until this got fixed that these guys disclosed it, since that's at least several months since then. A couple of bits of miscellany. I got a tweet relevant to this. Aspiring Lockpicker is his Twitter name. He says, at SGGRC, is it okay to install an offline-only antivirus like ClamWin? Or is it still issue-prone regarding OS hooks, delays, etc.? And so I just wanted to address the fact, because I saw other people asking too in the email bag, and that is that the biggest concern is something running all the time, because it always creates the vulnerability. So the idea of using an offline on-demand AV scanner, that's a much different problem, and I would argue much lesser concern than something that has persistently hooked itself deep into your OS in order to look into your encrypted connections to inspect them to make sure nothing bad is going on. And since it's doing that, it does present a much bigger persistent attack surface. An offline scanner that you run on demand doesn't create that problem. I also mentioned at the top of the show that a number of people had sent other crypto education links. There's crypto101.io, which is another very nice, I think it's 252-page PDF. Ed Felton at Princeton has an amazing 5-page encryption primer meant for like policymakers, like, you know, politicians who absolutely understand nothing. And I've seen it referred to as arguably the most clear, well-written piece of technical documentation in the history of man. Some simple diagrams. It's only 5 pages. And I wanted to note that I have created a new section on GRC's link farm page for free crypto education resources. And all of these links are there now. And it's fun. I also noticed I just Googled link farm and I was curious. GRC's link farm page is now, after the Wikipedia definition of the term, the first hit that Google returns. It might be biased because Google knows I am me, but it looks also like that page is becoming popular and Google has noticed it. So you can just put link farm into Google and you can probably find the one that you mean, which is GRC's link farm page. A quick tweet from Ryan McGinnis, who said at SGGRC, good God, The Expanse is killing it. When did sci-fi, meaning SYFI, the channel, go from B-movie schlock to HBO-quality space drama? Anyway, I agree. And many of our listeners are enjoying The Expanse, so I just wanted to remind people about that. Also, many people have been encountering this long-forgotten portable sound blaster or portable dog killer. I called it the Quiet Canine page at GRC. I had a whole bunch of pages that I never got around to fixing, but it's a constant source of interruption for me because people say, hey, whatever happened? So anyway, I fixed it all. For what it's worth, if you just put in grc.com/TQC for the Quiet Canine, there's now one page, has the schematic, the bill of materials, and it explains what we learned, which is you cannot get a dog to stop barking 3 doors down. But if you need a personal defense device, you know, if you're a postal worker who delivers mail on foot, or you're a jogger and dogs are nipping at your heels, this will convince them that, you know, they don't want to do that anymore. Lastly, I got a note, a follow-up from a couple months before. I shared with our listeners from someone who calls himself Glassair Pilot. He was the guy who ran Spinrite at level 2 on some drives in his RAID, which were constantly timing out and causing problems. And after doing that, even though Spinrite didn't say there was any problems found, no more timeouts. So he was kind enough yesterday to follow up and say, FYI, it's been almost 2 months since I did SRL2 on the 2 spinning drives out of 4 on my RAID 10. Zero warnings since then, and RAID has not gone critical since. So it's nice to know that whatever Spinrite did, it fixed it well. And I did want to share, I know you know, Leo, we had major storms in Southern California, well, in California, both in Northern California and Southern California. A little over 2 weeks ago, we had major winds that knocked out Sue's power.
Oh.
It was 2 years ago May that we had that experience that I shared with our listeners where Sue called me and said, my computer won't boot. And I said, oh. And she said, yeah, a while ago, it started complaining every time I turned it on about the RAID being critical, but said I could press escape to continue. So I have been. And so one drive went down. Everything was still working until the second drive went down. And I've talked often since then. This never occurred to me. But a RAID ought to say, okay, call IT.
Yeah,
it should not say, click here to ignore this warning.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So it happened again. However, Sue learned her lesson. This time, after the big storm, when she brought her machine back up, she got the big boot halt saying RAID critical, press escape to continue. This time, she phoned me.
Good.
She said, Steve, I got this error message and you told me not to ignore it this time. I said, oh, bless your heart. So I said, for now, press escape. I said, as soon as I can. I think this was like late the week before last. I ended up with our schedules not getting down to her until last Friday. And it was textbook perfect. I identified the one of the two drives that was the problem, removed it, put in a blank spare, rebooted. It noticed that the RAID was broken, offered to fix it. Oh, I should say that before even taking the system down, I used my favorite tool, which is Image for Windows, to make an image of the running system on an external drive so that nothing that then happened could cause me to lose from that point forward. Then we repaired the RAID, rebooted, we're all up and good again. So that's the way it's supposed to work. So Spinrite saved the day a couple years ago as a consequence of Sue just saying, oh, well, okay, I don't want to bother Steve, so I'm just going to hit escape because I'm not sure what this error message means. And that brings us to the first SHA-1 collision. We're out of time, but there's enough time. Essentially, you know, we've talked about hashes. We know I'm bullish on hashes. I love as a piece of a toolkit, what a hash allows you to do, because it takes a file of any size and reduces it to a unique set of bits that represent that file, such that even if you change one bit of the entire file or communication stream or whatever it is that you have hashed, then the cryptographically strong nature of the design of the hash means that on average, half of the bits will flip in the output if you just change any one bit in the input file. So just a cool technology. But a hash has several properties that make it worthwhile. And I thought I didn't want to bias this for this story, so I would read it right out of Wikipedia that says, a hash is deterministic, so the same message always results in the same hash. A hash is quick to compute for any given message. It is infeasible to generate a message from its hash, meaning to go backwards, except by trying all possible messages. A small change to a message should change the hash value so extensively that the new hash value appears uncorrelated with the old hash value. And the fourth principle of a hash, it is infeasible to find two different messages with the same hash value. That's what Google did. Now, to say they did it doesn't mean it was easy. And I know that you covered this, Leo. In Google's explanation of this, it took them years and 9 quintillion. That's 9,223,372,036,854,775,808 SHA-1 computations in total. That would be 6,500 years of GPU computation to complete the first phase of the attack and 110 additional years for the second phase. What this represents, though, is the first instance where we have had enough detailed understanding of, that is, our appreciation for how SHA-1 has matured, that that we understood how there was a potential flaw. And I'm looking in my notes to see if there's anything else I wanted to cover here. Google wrote, in 2013, Mark Stevens published a paper that outlined a theoretical approach to create an SHA-1 collision, meaning where two different texts can be deliberately designed so that they hash, either individually hash to the same thing. That's what is supposed to be impossible. So Google wrote, we started by creating a PDF prefix specifically crafted to allow us to generate two documents with arbitrary visual content, but that would hash to the same SHA-1 digest. In building this theoretical attack in practice, we had to overcome some new challenges. We then leveraged Google's technical expertise and cloud infrastructure, meaning lots of brute force computing, to compute the collision, meaning that they computed custom data that would be embedded in each of these PDFs that would not be seen, but would allow them to deliberately cause both different PDFs.
That makes sense.
To resolve to the same thing.
So they did the PDFs first without regard to the hash, and then started loading them up with data to make the hash.
And then embedded different data in the two of them. So what does this mean? This is, we've been talking about SHA-1 being sunsetted. This doesn't mean that suddenly it's broken. It doesn't mean that those things that are still using SHA-1 are suddenly vulnerable. But this is the way cryptography works, is that we chip away at this. And in fact, Leo, there's a fabulous link in my show notes. Oh, you don't have my show notes.
I don't have, yeah. Just tell me what it is. I'll Google it. I've been doing all along.
Yeah, it was a...
it took them, what was it, the equivalent of 100,000 years in computing time to create this collision. So it's merely the computing is getting faster and faster.
Okay, check this out. It's Valerie Arora, Valerie Aurora.
You don't have to spell it. Google doesn't care.
Oh, sorry. .org /hash.html.
Okay, good.
And what that shows, it's a wonderful chart that shows hashes that have been created over time, and then a horizontal timeline of how they have been weakened, first problems found, vulnerabilities, and then total breakage. So a really, really nice chart that will be in the show notes. As soon as we're through recording here, I will get them converted to a doc and a PDF and get them posted and tweet.
And it's exactly the curve you'd expect,
Yes.
As computing power increases, and I mean, eventually computer power will increase to the point where, a 2048-bit RSA key won't be sufficient.
Well, and of course, the big scary bugaboo is quantum.
Right.
Does that suddenly, can you suddenly solve all the problems at once somehow?
Right.
And at this moment, you can, as long as there's only 16 of them. That is, if you need to find which pattern of 4 bits that we can do with a qubit, a quantum four state thing somehow. But, you know, we don't have 4 bits. We have 256. And the problem doesn't scale linearly. It scales exponentially. So we're safe for the time being. But again, this is the way these things happen. They get chipped
away. And Aurora's hierarchy goes, assumed to be weak, but no one bothers to break. Then collisions generated by hand. Then meaningful collisions generated on home computer. We're not there yet with SHA-1.
Then no.
First collision found, serious weakness discovered, minor weakness discovered, general acceptance, peer review, initial proposal. So we're still at first collision found. We've got meaningful collisions on home computer. We're probably a way off from that, I would think.
Well, and you're right. You're exactly right. And what we have seen, if there's another major lesson that our listeners have now seen play out over and over and over, is that legacy crypto is hard to kill. You know, it is just, you know, when they tried to just stop using SHA-1 for TLS, it was like, no.
Well, was I wrong? Google still uses SHA-1 in its certs, but they expire them in 3 months.
Well, yeah, although that's a different case because a self-signed cert can be used. You don't have a collision problem there. So root certs can be signed by SHA-1, just not endpoint certs.
I got it. Okay.
So anyway, so it's not the end of the world. This is the way this happens. Again, hats off to Google for, investing in 9 quintillion-plus SHA-1 cycles. It's like, and can you imagine how you'd feel? It's like, oh my goodness, did it really work? And then you'd check it again by hand and double check it and make sure. It's like, we just created
a collision. Yeah.
Yes. The first. So again, this is not something that is going to hurt us, and everybody is moving away from SHA-1 as quickly as possible. Nobody today would ever build a new system using SHA-1.
Right.
So eventually, those dinosaurs that are still around will end up dying off, and we'll all be at SHA-256, which has a bright future.
Right. Steve, as always, I think you have a bright future in this security thing. You might want to consider doing a podcast or something.
How about next week?
Next week? Okay.
Yeah.
Every Wednesday. I'm sorry, Tuesday. You know, how long ago did we change it to Tuesday? One of these days it'll sink in.
Oh, I'm liking it on Tuesday because I noticed that Mondays get skipped on President's Day and things.
That's right.
Like, I'm really happy with my Tuesday.
Every other employee is praying for a day off, a 3-day weekend, but you say, I don't want to miss an episode. And that's why we love you. Steve Gibson, GRC.com. If you go there, what will you find? Well, you will find some wonderful stuff, including Spinrite, Steve's bread and butter, the world's finest hard drive and recovery utility. You'll also find the podcast itself and handwritten transcriptions and show notes. In this case, it's the only place you can find show notes until Steve gets them up. I'm sure you'll get them up in minutes after the show's over.
Yep.
What else can you find there? You can find, perfect paper passwords and the healthy sleep formula and all those great things Steve does for us. And those are all free. GRC.com. If you come here, you'll get video and audio as well as a lovely feeling when you see the beautiful Twit website. I got nothing. Steve's got all the good stuff. I just have podcasts over here. And you can also watch live, as I said, every Tuesday, 1:30 Pacific, 4:30 Eastern. That's 21:30 UTC. And we're usually done by this time, but thank you to Megan and Jason for their patience. They're going to start TNT in just a second. And, of course, you should subscribe because, really, you want a complete set of Security Now podcasts. You can get them leather-bound and put them on your bookshelf. You'll be the pride of your commune. Thank you, Steve. Go watch the State of the Union address. That's what I'm going to do.
Oh, I've got it. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Well, or the address to Congress, actually.
I guess it's not the State of the Union. It's just the address.
Correct.
Right.
Yep. Thank you, my friend. And I will do it 1:30 sharp next week.
Yes.
Come hell or high water.
Yes.
And
well, prop, maybe. Prop. No.
Yeah.
Unless Cox screws up again. And then.
Well, I was going to say, props to Cox. Once it came back up, not a single dropped packet the entire time.
Maybe they were fixing, you know, maybe they were fixing the network for you so that it'll be perfect from now on.
Let's think that. Let's think that.
That's what
I actually, even Cox reached out and tweeted me asking if I needed any assistance.
Oh, good.
This got elevated to their attention.
Well, yeah. In fact, when I went to the outage page, they have a little section on the side of tweets. It was all about security now, so I'm sure they were aware of the issue. Thanks, Steve. We'll see you next time on Security Now.
Thanks, Leo.